Radio starts now. This is GlobalNewsForum.com, Chicago.
It's time now for the Bean Soup Times Radio Show with your host, Tore Muhammad, heard every Wednesday, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. Central Standard Time, right here on GlobalNewsForum.com. And now, your host.
What's up? What's up? Peace. Hotep. Assalamu alaikum. Praise the Lord.
Barangani.
What's happening? Brothers and sisters, once again, it's that time. It's the top of the hour, a little bit after 3, and you are listening to Tore Muhammad. This is the Bean Soup Radio Show. We're right here at Global News Forum, right here on the South Side, in the heart of the South Shore community, a place I hold dear. It's where I grew up, and it's always a pleasure to be here. We are very happy to have to be here at the Global News Forum studios, and man, we have a giant in the building today to talk to. She's no stranger to the airwaves. We're going to get right into it. Maybe we'll talk about some current events as we go. We definitely have one to talk about. That she's doing some phenomenal things with and for our community, and we want to get right into it. So listen, tell a friend to tell a friend to tune in to the Bean Soup Radio Show, and make sure that you tell everyone on Facebook that it's time. Tell your mama, tell your uncle, tell everybody. Tune in right now. We're going to have, as always, something for you to use and to share and to edify you. And matter of fact, I'm sure you're going to get some marching orders today, real soon. So without any further ado, we want to welcome to Bean Soup Radio the wonderful, the fabulous, the incredible Deborah Crable is in the building.
Wow. All that, huh?
All of that.
I am with the master of the universe.
That's right.
It is my honor to be here and to be in your presence. Absolutely.
Well, thank you. Absolutely. I'm humbled by that statement. We are, you know, I guess they say wherever two or more are gathered in my name, I am there.
Yes. The great I am.
That's right. So, Sister Deborah, you always are doing some great work in the community, whether it's through Kennedy King College, whether it's through a bunch of things. I know last time you were talking about the interrupters, but some people may not know, of course, that you do a lot of work around helping businesses grow, helping people who are in marketing and to get the word out, to get a message out about their product, service, and cause. And you have been a mentor and a teacher and an advocate for folks through the National Alliance of Marketer Developers. You've come up through the ranks and done a lot of great work there.
Thank you.
That's what we're going to be talking about today, something that I'm telling you, when I put, if you all haven't seen on my website, I have an article that Sister Deborah sent me that I posted talking about the power of black women, the power of women, and the how they can affect the economy.
Yes.
And that blog post got more hits in the past week and a half than anything else on my website.
Bravo.
So tell us what's going on.
Hey, Brother Tore! it really is. It's about knowing your power.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll give you a little backdrop on two things. First, the National Alliance of Market Developers is one of the oldest black professional organizations in the country.
Really?
Yes, we were formed, we're celebrating our 60th anniversary this year here in Chicago.
Uh-huh.
So the founders and the early membership of this organization were the first ones to say, look, there's money out there in them Black Hills that corporate America is not paying attention to.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So they went out to really define what that marketplace looked like.
Wow.
And what they discovered 60 years ago is that it amounted to about $30 billion in...
60 years ago.
60 years ago. And now it is eclipsing $1 trillion.
Right.
Okay?
Yes.
So that is a lot of money and a lot of growth.
That is.
Now, I've been inside of this conversation for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But again, let me backtrack a little bit to let you know how they were able to leverage that information back then. So when we talk about the civil rights movement mm-hmm. and how we all got caught up with Dr. Martin Luther King and mm-hmm. the civil rights issues of the day right. and the marches and what have you, well, it was the information that we had, okay, about where we were putting our money, how we were spending our money, and with whom we were spending our money, which corporations. Uh-huh. Was it going into Sears? Was it going to Montgomery Gore's? Wherever it was going. And those companies that were not treating black people right,
mm-hmm.
they were able to use this information, the research data, to say, nah, this is what we're bringing to you. This is how we are impacting your bottom line. Mm-hmm. You don't give us what we want, we're shutting you down.
Mm, that's power.
That is power. Now, let me fast forward to 2012.
Yes.
So I am sitting in the conference that Burrell Communications does every year,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Primarily to state the case for advertising black to mm-hmm. all of their clients. Well, they opened it up this year to other individuals.
Mm-hmm.
So when the Census Bureau made their presentation, and they said, you know, 63% of all black households are led by single black women.
Mm-hmm.
There was a ripple effect that went,
63%.
Yeah. Now, I understand what that represents. Now, I'm not just talking about black women who have never been married.
Mm-hmm.
This is black women who have never been married, black women who have been married and divorced,
mm-hmm.
Black women who have non-traditional companion relationships,
mm-hmm.
People whose spouses have died. These right. might be your grandmother who is now taking over ownership of the
right.
family for whatever reason.
Right.
So what that represents
wow.
is a profile of many and many different capacities.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of a long or a short day, it is a black woman who is making a decision over how the dollars flow and go in that household.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what about overall of all black households?
Right.
In all black households, in 80% of those households, she has a major decision-making voice
mm-hmm.
and how the money goes and flows.
Uh-huh. Right.
So I went home after hearing that statistic, and I was talking to a few friends, and, you know, it kind of went over like the 747, because, again, we've been in this conversation and seen these statistics time and time again.
Right.
And I went home, and I said, hold it right there. Because if we're in the conversation about buy black,
mm-hmm.
advancing anything black,
mm-hmm.
it means that black women
right.
are making the determining factor, are the determining factor in how it will be shaped, formed,
mm-hmm.
framed, moved.
Right.
So what does that mean? That means that the black women, when we're sitting in the kitchen and you're having your family dinner, however it is y'all break that stuff down now,
right.
however you lay down the edict of the land in your household,
right.
we need to be driving, throwing down what the edict of the land is going to be around our money.
That's right.
Because we are the shapers, we are the nurturers, we are the educators, we are the ones who discipline, we are the ones that tell you how to do and what to do. Come
mm-hmm.
on now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm calling on Big Mama and Little Mama.
Mm-hmm.
Step up to the plate.
Mm-hmm.
Understand how you are rolling. Understand the responsibility of what you have in, of being the custodian
right.
of that $1 trillion. Now, I'm not saying don't go out and spend your money and have a happy day when you want to.
Right.
But what I am saying, what I'm hoping women will do, is to come together on this Saturday at the Crown Plaza Hotel mm-hmm. over in Greektown so we can have a conversation on how we can impact this.
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
I know you have been a champion of Buy Black for as long as I've known you.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't seen it crystallize the way that it needs to.
Right.
But the same as Mama will sit there and tell you you're going to church every Sunday,
right.
you can go to school every weekday. You can sit down. You're going to do your homework. You're going to do all the things that you know we value
mm-hmm.
and that we cherish.
Mm-hmm.
That she also needs to be framing this conversation about our money.
Mm-hmm.
So it's okay for you to go down to Macy's when they have their full day half off sale.
Right. That's right.
But I want you to make the conscientious choice to go across the street to the brother who's selling the baked bread. That's the black shop owner,
mm-hmm.
and I want you to conscientiously say that when I buy my bread, I'm going to go over there. Now, if you need to go over to Dominic's or to wherever it is you need to go, or Jewel, it's okay to do that,
mm-hmm.
but I want you to really be thinking, to understand
come on, that's right.
that you also need to be making the conscientious choice
mm-hmm.
to go and do something that will support your community
mm-hmm.
and your family. So it has to happen on that granular level, I will call it. It's a grassroots, Mama said, so I do level. And that is where I think we will be able to see a quantum leap and change in how we think, move, distribute, and handle our wealth.
Mm-hmm. That's excellent. That makes so much sense. And, you know, it's so important, I think, for us to highlight. When you look at economies and you look at what happens to economies when they begin to fall, the first thing that the people in that city, that community, that group, that ethnic group, whatever it is, the first thing they do is start in focusing on, they start focusing on what they can do to support and start funneling money to and from each other.
Exactly.
What's happening in California? Economy's going bad. Schwarzenegger was saying, buy California. What's happening in America now that all the jobs have been shipped out and everything is being made and sold in China and Japan and everywhere else? Then our government is saying, buy American. You're talking about the car industry. Buy American. So we're doing just what makes sense, encouraging each other to spend money with each other. And I love the way you put that, because oftentimes when people talk about buying black, then for some reason, you know, if they see me in a grocery store, they say, well, what you doing in here? I said, well, I never said spend all your money, because you can't do it.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. And
but
that's
spend
it.
Some of it. Make
exactly.
sure it's directed somewhere. So you said that very well.
But the other part of it, and you bring it up most appropriately, it's not just about our black economy, but it's how we are impacting the American economy.
That's right.
What we need to understand as black people is that proportionately, we are the number one consumer in this country. If we take a look at what happened down in Hurricane Katrina, when everything was flooded and washed out, their whole economic infrastructure collapsed because there were no black people there.
Right.
You know, in those restaurants,
that's
making
right.
it happen.
That's right.
And so when that first layer of that infrastructure started coming back,
right,
then we started seeing it build back up. Understand your power.
That's right. That's
okay?
Right.
So, and the same thing here. We are off the index charts. When they do the measurement of where we buy and how we buy, I don't care what it is. We are off the chart.
We're off the chart.
So if you're talking about a cell phone, we
right.
don't have one. We got two.
Right. That's right.
If not three. Okay. And that's just how we roll.
Right.
So when you start talking about the digital divide, there is no digital divide.
That's right.
Because if you can operate an Android, if you can operate an iPhone, which I cannot,
right.
I don't even know all the functions of my phone.
That's right.
You understand computer technology and digital technology.
That's right.
And you know where we
and
go to
talk
get
about the games,
the
video
games,
the Xbox. And
oh my gosh,
yeah,
we're off the charts with that.
Mm-hmm.
But here's something else they told me I found very, very interesting. We are savvy consumers. We just don't go and buy. We get online. We go online and we check it out.
That's right.
Here we go. Bam, 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 bam. They got a sale going on. And we also are leading on the sales online. We just like to spend
money. That's right.
We really
right.
do.
And we like sales. We like hookups.
We like a hookup. And so there's nothing wrong with that.
Right.
But I'm just saying, be very clear. Be very present to what you have and how we are rolling.
That's right.
The cup is not half empty. It is half full, if not overflowing. Now, we can counter that with all the negative statistics, but trust me, they are going after your dollar.
That's right.
They're going after your dollar. They have researched it. They have indexed it. They know that you are loyal. They know that once you get logged into one company, you're
right.
going to stay with them for life.
That's right.
And I can tell you a story about my own mother. Sears did her wrong 40 years ago, if not 50 years ago. She hadn't been back to Sears
since.
Okay. So, I mean, this is how it goes.
Right.
The vacuum cleaner that she got, you know, we still buying it. We still buy it. It's like a family tradition now.
Right.
If you don't have that one, then you just aren't in with the groove of
right,
things.
Right.
And the other thing that they show in particular about women and how we buy, when we go out shopping, to your point, we always are looking for the bargain. So when we find the bargain, what do? We don't just buy what we need. What do?
You're either going to buy more than you need so you can give it to friends, or you're going to tell your friends where to go get it so they can get
you
it before the sale
ends. You are absolutely right. You are absolutely right.
That's right.
We're going to say, oh, this is good. Let me go and buy it. You're going to buy 3, 4, 5 of them.
Right.
And you're going to hand them out. You're going to save them for some Christmas or birthday gifts.
Right.
Or you're going to call, just like what you said, and I have done all of that.
Mm-hmm.
We're very charitable. which is a good trade.
That's right.
And when you go over there to that Macy's store, I can't tell you how often I've been standing going through the racks.
Right.
Sister, roll up on girl, do you need a coupon? Okay,
right.
We will hand out the coupons, encouraging each other.
That's
Right. Hand out coupons.
Know.
Greater
even
don't even know them. May never see them again in life.
Right.
Okay, but I want women to come together so we can aggregate what this really means. And when you go online, and I will be posting this today on my Facebook page, and I've offered it to you as well.
Yes.
Where I have all of our panelists giving a direct invitation to women to come out and to be a part of this conversation.
Yes.
We have McGee Williams-Osei from Burrell Communications, co-CEO of Burrell Communications. We have, absolutely, Sandra Finley, chairman, CEO, League of Black Women, who had just came back a week and a half ago from a similar conference at the White House.
Wow.
Watch this, ladies. They're watching. They are watching. And there's a lot of people getting in on this because they know who we are with this. They know who we are.
That's right.
They're
That's
saying
right.
women are driving this.
That's
so
right.
They had an economic forum for women talking about how y'all going to, you know, get a grip on this.
Right.
At
right.
the White House,
right, the White
President
House.
Barack Obama wants to know.
That's beautiful.
Now, I
That's
called
important.
Sandra before she went. I didn't have a clue about this. And I said, well, this is really, hi, how you doing? A real strong, strong,
another
strong. Another giant just walked in the house. Let me yield to the brook. Another master of greatness. So I'm just saying that if everyone else is clocking and measuring and knowing,
right.
then we need to be in the space of knowing what we have.
That's right.
And to make that very conscious choice.
That's right. That's
so
right.
I'm inviting women to come out and to join us for that. We have Glisby. She's a senior director of supplier diversity with Walgreens, and she initiated the Community Corner Project, which was driven by women consumers. Off the chain. Company didn't want to do it. They did it. It's been off the chain. So I want women to understand that as an example of what happens when we make a very conscious, unified choice.
That's right.
When we direct it and the impact that it can have.
Right.
And we can lift up a gazillion examples. We can look at black voting.
Right.
Okay.
That's right.
And how
it's
we can
power.
Make that work. I have a friend of mine, many of me have seen these emails from like Steve Mitchell, and you'll do the takeover. So what happens when you take over a venue for a night and it's nothing but black people coming in there spending their money?
Right, right.
You feel the impact in that one occasion. I'm saying that with $1 trillion, we need to be doing it clear across
the board. That's right.
Absolutely.
And, you know, and it's so beautiful. There's such an impact that we have where we spend. And for the savvy entrepreneur, for the person who's trying to figure out how to get into business, we are an incredible market to do it in. You're talking about a trillion, all these trillions of dollars. It takes only 1,000 millions to equal 1 billion.
Well, I'm trying to get to my first
how many
million.
Millionaires, right? Me too. Let's get there.
And we can.
That's right.
And so, I mean, what would it be like for Oprah, whom, you know, we have celebrated for years, who charted the course for us? Now she's out there on her own and understanding what it really is like to be an entrepreneur. And I'm sure she's feeling what it means to be a black entrepreneur out there. What would it be like? What would it be like? Now watch this. I saw where WGN, they were getting ready to get kicked off of DirecTV. They sent out a notice telling everybody, look, y'all better call DirecTV.
That's right.
They're getting ready to take us down.
Right.
I think they went off for a minute because I was swimming the channels. I didn't see them. Maybe it was just me. But they are there. Why can't we do the same thing for Oprah?
That's right.
Even if you watch or you don't watch, you call, start calling everybody saying, look, we want to see
Oprah.
We
want to see on it.
Where is she? And I got an email from her saying, just put in your zip code, what service you have, and I'll tell you where we are on the dial.
That's right.
So you preset your TV to the own network so that when Nielsen measures that, you're locked in. You're locked in radio, and she gets that number.
That's right. That's what we need.
Yes.
So that's power right there. So, Sister Deborah, tell us again the date and how people can get to this important conference.
The conference is with the National Alliance of Market Developers. The conference is Friday and on Saturday of this week at the Crown Plaza Hotel right over there in Greektown, just west of the expressway. So it's very easy to get to. The theme of our conference is the Urban Market Influencers 21st Century Game Changers. And we have just a slew of luminaries in the marketing industry that will be there, you know, giving you much of the information I've been sharing this afternoon. But I do want to issue again that very special plea, because another one of our special guests on Saturday morning, a.m., and I suggest that you get there early, ladies. And men are invited, too. Men are invited, too, because you're a critical part of this conversation, is Reverend Jeanette Wilson. Because when I issued a call, I went to Second John, and I said, give me the elect woman. And this is a woman who was single, had her family, but she was recognized as one who really was a believer and following what the Lord wanted her to do. So the call is for those women, the elect women, who can impact that next generation, your children, so that we can move this forward in a very substantive, high-impact way. This is our legacy, for us to create, for us to be the architects of, and for us to celebrate. Do not take this lightly. No one else is. They're taking you very seriously.
That's right.
Take yourself seriously. Take your culture seriously. Take the fact that you are a strong, brilliant black woman seriously, and step up to the plate. Man. And I'll see you on Saturday.
That's what's up now. That is, we're talking about the modern, present-day Harriet Tubman, brothers and sisters, leading us to freedom, financial freedom for business, for our community. It's so important. So, look, do you have time to stick around for a minute?
Yeah, for a few minutes.
Okay.
I gotta educate some young black minds.
You gotta educate some young black minds. We're gonna make sure that we put that the audio clips so we can hear from those young women today on our website. And make sure we get it to your Facebook page.
Yes, please do.
Yeah. So how they find you on Facebook?
Deborah Crable, D-E-B-O-R-H.
Beautiful.
Crable, C-R-A-B-L-E.
Make sure you check it out. And this is such a wonderful segue, because we have an institution in our community that is like many that are so important, so critical. And, you know, I love to be able to tell folks, support something not just because it's black, but because it's black excellence. And we're going to talk to ETA right now. We have my Morehouse brother and friend. Man, wait a minute, you're looking good, man. You've been working out, huh?
Been working out, yeah.
I was looking at through my peripheral. I got a full-blown look at him, man. What's up? 30 after. And so, so we just want to introduce you, and then we're going to take a quick break, and then we want to just have some nice conversations with you and talk about what's happening at ETA. But, man, we thank you for being here, and tell everybody, say what's up.
What's up? I'm glad to follow the beautiful, vivacious, dynamic Deborah Crable, who I've always been a fan of and happy to be a colleague of now.
Absolutely.
And certainly after her segue, I'm going to this conference. You know, ETA was one of the founders, was this dynamic black woman who resonated with everything you said about the importance of culture, but also the importance of putting something in our community that's an economic engine. We employ actors, artists, directors, artisans. We're the ancillary services that, you know, cleaning services and all of the kind of businesses and vendors we use. The million-plus dollars that goes through ETA goes directly in salaries and fees to mostly black-owned businesses or black people. And we're very proud of that contribution we make annually to the local economy.
You know,
man,
I just want
to
add just one last thing.
When
we make that conscious choice, and how it became very real for me, and there are a couple of, you know, not vendors, but shop owners that I will frequent, and there's one lady that I would buy from frequently. And so when I think about the contrast between going through the stacks at Macy's and going to her shop, where I could see her two little children running around, I see the face of where my money is going and what it is supporting.
Those children are now grown.
That's exactly
on their way to college.
That
my investment in her shop not only made me feel good, it gave me garments to wear, but it also supported her family and her ability to provide for her children. Faces that I saw and know
that's
and
right.
call my name.
You know what? I have to say this, because you just moved me with that. And this is going to be a confessional. It's been times, because I've been doing Bean Soup Times for 10 years, 11 years now.
Yes.
Right? It's been times when I've gotten the word out and helped folks do a great job. but the money wasn't coming in like I wanted to, and I am at my last $5, and I'm trying to figure out, man, how is the family going to eat tonight? And somebody calls me to do an email blast, and before I look up, the money's in my account, and my children were eating that night.
Yes.
Because somebody patronized my business. So you're absolutely right.
No, it make a difference.
That $10, 20, whatever little amount that you think it is, you don't know how much of an impact it made for that business owner at that time.
Yeah. Well, extrapolate that over our entire community. I mean, right. If we get back to that mindset, I mean, this is how immigrant communities run. This is why you
That's
have
right.
a vibrant business district in a place like Pilsen.
Right.
It's all of these immigrants who come over here with nothing.
That's but it, right.
I mean, hey, there's 5 or 6 groceries and Mexican restaurants and cleaners, and it's supporting your own. It's being very conscious about that. And that feeds our families. That feeds our economic development. In your own community where you live.
That's right.
Your neighbors, we employ ourselves.
That's right.
You know, there's certain structural things that happen in the economy. That ship has left the station. We can control this, though.
That's
we can
right.
control exactly. what we do with our dollars now.
That's right, man. Amen. That is so right, man. This is a wonderful, wonderful discussion we're having. I thank you so much, brothers and sisters, just listening to Being Sue Radio. I'm your host, Tori Muhammad. We have the incredible Deborah Crable. I'm not going to hit the table again because Lamont told me stop hitting the table. So excuse me if you all heard that, my excitement. And we have Phillip Thomas from ETA. And, man, so much is happening. Tell us about some of the events you have coming up at ETA right now.
Oh, the thing what we're really proud of right now is a show called Tangled.
Yes, I heard about that.
It is this dynamic play written by Nicole Cobb Anderson.
Mm-hmm.
It is a play that's about a family of funeral home directors. They're all female. And just their reaction to the violence they see in our community. And really, what the play really exhorts us to do as a community is take back the power to have peace in our community.
Mm.
It's part of a series we're having at ETA called Reclaiming the Community. And we happen to believe in the philosophy of this play, and the philosophy that's behind it is that we cannot give up the power to control the destiny of our own community.
Right.
Yeah. That
that's
is
what
ours
I'm
to
about.
That is
up.
Ours to control. And everyone can't do big global things, but you can do the stuff with the neighbor. You can reach that young kid that's on the block.
Right.
You can do one-on-one. You can take some kids to lunch. You can find jobs in economic development, yeah. maybe for a couple of kids.
Mm-hmm.
But we all have to contribute to this, and it's all part of the fabric that makes community, and that's what we're missing, and that's why we think there's so much violence. It's this kind of self-imposed isolation we have mm-hmm. with our neighbor, and we're afraid of our children, and but we cannot afford that anymore. It's not a police problem. The police come after it at best.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, but we have to be about the prevention mindset, the elevation mindset in terms of our community and our children. They are our children. We have to stop being afraid of them.
Man, I love it. I love it, brother. And that is so important. We all have to accept responsibility for our own community. And if all of us just take the time to say, you know what, I'm responsible. How can I help? If everybody did that, it would be solved overnight. But the beautiful thing is everybody doesn't have to do it immediately. If just a few mm-hmm. courageous leaders do it, like these two sitting here right with me today are doing, man, and more of us get together and connect those dots, we can and we have to. Our very survival is at hand right now. We have to take charge of our community. And I love the way you said we cannot be afraid of our own self, really, because when we look out in the community and see anybody doing something foolish, we're looking at ourselves.
Mm. Yes, absolutely.
You know, we are mirror images, the good and the bad. And until we seize the reins of our community, somebody else is going to keep riding, and I don't know who that is.
Hey, it's not snitching to protect your own. It's not
That's
snitching.
Right.
That is not a negative thing to protect your own community.
That's right. We must do that. We must protect ourselves from, like they say in the armed forces, from enemies foreign and domestic.
I heard that.
But look, we're going to take a quick break and be right back with more of the Bean Soup Radio Show. Thank you.
is GlobalNewsForum.com.
The African-American woman rests at the core of the African-American community. In many instances, she is the head of the household. She is the breadwinner. She's in control of $1 trillion of spending power. That's pretty significant, and that makes her a powerhouse in our economic community.
The importance of this conversation is we're going to make a direct plea to black women, to women of color, to take charge of the economic impact that our dollars have in the modern $1 trillion economy and the American economy.
Well, when we think about the black consumer economy, $1 trillion, that is a number that most of us cannot even imagine and cannot quantify on an individual level. But to have the power to either margin a profit for a corporation or be the margin of competition for a corporation is a powerful statement.
Black woman consumer is very important to Walgreens. 40% of Walgreens stores are in diverse communities, and we know that 78% of our shoppers are female. So this is a core piece of our target market, and therefore we're always in a position to want to serve and learn more.
The communication will be that there is economic legacy for the next generations to take out and invest in what they see as our possibilities. And they will make decisions based on a legacy of entitlement and empowerment and money versus debt, concern, and worry.
Saturday, we want people to understand how important she is, that this woman cannot be devalued or ignored.
It's Bean Soup Times Radio Show with Torrey Muhammad on GlobalNewsForum.com.
Hi, this is Lisa connecting you to George with another Bean Soup Times Celebrity Philanthropy Update. I'm definitely hoping that each of you is having a great day today. Giving is always in the collective nature of the human race. Mainstream tends to forget about that, or rather, chooses not to highlight it, but giving is always alive and always ongoing. According to Black Celebrity Giving, star power was alive and well in downtown Chicago recently as celebrities and supporters joined hometown Grammy-winning hip-hop artist Common. The second annual gala and fundraiser was hosted by the Common Ground Foundation and shined a light on men who've made a positive impact in the African American community. Now, how about that? The event was held at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel and was a sold-out affair. This year, the foundation honored men of excellence, including actor and activist Mr. Harry Belafonte. Other honorees for the gala included Chicago Bears, Israel Indonesi, I probably messed that name up, Boeing Cooperative Executive Vice President James A. Bell, and Million Dollar Scholar founder Darius Quarles. Common has a foundation. Why, yes. Can you believe that? The Common Ground Foundation was founded by hip-hop artist Lonnie Rashid Lynn Jr., known as Common. Over 10 years ago, this megastar committed his time and resources to help underserved youth in his hometown. That is Chicago. And today, the foundation partners with several organizations, impacts hundreds of youth each year. In 2012, his foundation will host its first annual Commons Summer Youth Program in Plymouth, Wisconsin, with incoming freshmen from Chicago Public Schools. Now that is beyond incredible. So check out the foundation's work at commongroundfoundation.org. That's commongroundfoundation.org. Jermaine Lamar Cole, better known to the world by his stage name J. Cole. This 27-year-old rapper and record producer was the first rap artist signed to Jay-Z's label Roc Nation in 2009 and released his long-awaited debut album, Cold World. Now, we all remember that, on September 27th, 2011. The album debuted at number one on the U.S. Billboard 200, top R&B albums, and top rap albums chart. It has sold more than 217,000 in its first week sales. He received a nomination for Best New Artist at the 54th Grammy Awards. And so, although busy carving out his musical niche, this rising star has taken out time to establish the Dreamville Foundation. Now, I bet you can imagine what that's all about. founded in October 2011 to uplift the urban youth of Fayetteville, North Carolina, the foundation seeks to bridge the gap between them and the world of opportunities that are available. After moving to New York to attend college, J. Cole realized the world has so much more to offer beyond the borders of his hometown Fayetteville. He strives to make the youth of Fayetteville aware of their potential and opportunities through promoting education and creating programs and events that will allow our youth to be set up for success. Set up for success. Wow. At an early age, J. Cole knew he wanted to be a rapper, and through his foundation, he encourages urban youth to have dreams, believe in their dreams, and achieve their dreams. The mission of his foundation is really simple: to reveal to the urban youth their limitless potential through positive life-altering experiences. The rapper in Fayetteville native recently presented the Nobody's Writing Contest for local awards. For local children, so I'm sure we'll be finding out the results of that soon. Recently, my company has been working with multi-award-winning artist Kanya Doss to make a difference in the lives of trafficked children in Haiti, raise awareness for the global water crisis, and encourage HIV-positive individuals to be better advocates of their health. Exciting, huh? We think so. But since it's always nice to have something to look forward to, I will share more on this exciting philanthropic efforts in the near future. Well, as you know, I can always go on and on talking about celebrity philanthropy, but I will save some for next time. This is Lisa connecting you to George, reporting for Bean Soup Times. Have a great day.
All the expensive advertisement. Oh, here we're back. We're back. Welcome back, brothers and sisters. I hope you enjoyed that celebrity report from Lisa George. She is wonderful, and we want to say a sorrowful goodbye.
Oh.
Deborah Crable has to leave us, but we want to make sure that everyone knows, again, the time, the location, and where they can get more information about this important, the 60th annual conference. And that has to be recognized, because outside of our fraternities and sororities and the Nation of Islam, I don't know any organization that's been around 60-plus years.
Exactly.
That's power exactly. Right there.
That is. It's very, very, very bad. And a lot of the other professional, black professional organizations evolved out of NAMD. And your sales and marketing, your beepers, black populations.
Uh-huh. Yes, yes.
Black advertisers. You know, so they all kind of, that was the beginning, and they kind of grew out of that. So I do want to also say, for those of you who did hear on the other side of the break, the montage of women talking about Know Your Power are the ones who will be featured. And you heard them offer a direct plea to black women to come on Saturday morning,
right,
9 a.m. at the Crown Plaza Hotel in Greektown. I need you to come early. This will be an information-filled session. I'm having a conversation with the ladies now so that we might have some directives that will be deliverables and takeaways from that session that
beautiful.
You can immediately put into action. But this is not a situation where we want to dictate. This is an interactive conversation. So if you are an elect woman, and I'm sure everyone within hearing range of my voice is, then I need you to bring your brilliance, your brain trust, down to the Crown Plaza Hotel with the National Alliance of Market Developers. Go online at NAMDNTL.org to get additional information. That's NAMDNTL.org. NTL is for international, .org, O-R-G. Mm-hmm. And all the information is right there and available for you.
Okay, beautiful.
But I do want to tell you, I got my 0.0001% in my hand right now in the envelope. The mega lottery.
You won in the mega lottery?
I got $1.25. Praise the Lord, okay? I'm going to the bank.
How much did the ticket cost?
The ticket was $5. I didn't even start on the ticket. This is what we're talking about, okay? Don't give your power away. No. Reclaim your power and make it work for you.
That's right. Beautiful. Well, thank you, Sister Deborah, for being on
wonderful.
The show.
Always wonderful, Deborah.
We love
great
you
to see
for
you,
all that you do.
Yes,
and,
absolutely.
And thank you so much. And, you know, for me, it's always sitting here kind of a little nervous because you got a radio veteran that I'm sitting across from. So I'm trying to cross
all media.
T's and dot
queen
my
of all
I's.
Media.
Right, queen
absolutely.
Of all media. So
absolutely.
We thank you. And thank you're you. Always welcome, of course, on the Bean Soup Show.
Love you.
All right.
All right.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Brother Phillip, so talk to us, man. My Morehouse brother.
Yes, brother.
Doing what we were encouraged to do at Morehouse is to become leaders in our community. And you are doing a wonderful job over at ETA, such an important institution. You mentioned several things in terms of helping to create an economy or strengthen our economy because of all the people who work in and around ETA.
Yes.
And I also want to add,
after
it's so wonderful. Right, in 41 years.
Yes.
And you also help people to tell just such important and incredible stories.
Yes.
Tangled, like you just mentioned, you're not going to necessarily get those kind of stories everywhere. So.
Oh, that's absolutely right. I mean, ETA is created to tell the first story, our
mm-hmm.
story,
mm-hmm.
in the first person, our own story and our own voice.
Mm.
You know, we want authentic projections of African-American life and lifestyles. That's
right.
written into our mission. And
right.
this particular story, it just hits home right now with all the violence that's taking place in our community. I think from the outside, there's a perception that there are not people inside concerned.
Right,
and
right.
what this does is take you through the journey of a family of women and one person in particular who has to think about, well, what am I doing? What
mm-hmm.
is my contribution to stopping this horrible violence? And
mm-hmm.
we see that, you know, through the headlines that it's increasing
mm-hmm.
right now. This is like, you know, I guess because it's been a little warm, and we... It's just so crazy to me that we even think that that's a reasonable excuse.
Right, exactly.
Good weather means that we have
it's
to kill
each other.
It's
getting warm outside. Uh-oh,
it's
going to be some trouble.
It's absolutely insane. It's time for us to stop the insanity. So what we're doing with this play, because it's so topical and brings up these issues, is coupling it with Thursday night talkbacks,
mm-hmm.
where we have leaders in the community lead conversations post-show, after the show,
mm-hmm.
that are about solutions. Now that we've heard what the problem is, we don't need a further recitation of how bad it is.
Right.
What's
right.
the way forward?
Right.
And the way forward is in our hands. So you hear all kinds of things. And these discussions, you hear people who've personally experienced violence. There was a sister there last week when we had Kendall Moore from WVON,
mm-hmm.
if I can say WVON.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's my man, Kendall.
He
Kendall.
Was great. Very dynamic, very, you know, challenging. But there was a sister there whose daughter,
mm-hmm.
had been shot in the head,
mm-hmm.
just innocently
oh.
sitting in on her porch, got shot in the head,
mm-hmm.
been through numerous surgeries, major
mm-hmm.
surgeries and brain surgeries, and then her son has been killed 3 months ago, her son.
Wow.
So both her son and her daughter have been victims of violence.
Mm-hmm.
Her family has had to deal with the aftermath of it because
mm-hmm.
we, you know, you see the headlines, but you don't understand. They're going to be dealing with this.
Right. That's right.
For probably their
once
whole
the cameras
lives.
Are gone. That's right.
And we don't see that. So we're dealing with that. This Thursday we have Father Flager.
Mm-hmm.
We'll
mm-hmm.
be leading a discussion.
Mm-hmm.
After that we have Diane Latiker, who's from
Kids
Off the Block,
block. Right,
a
right.
fantastic organization
right.
that works with youth directly. Amina Matthews from The Interrupters.
Yes.
From that wonderful documentary.
Right.
If folks haven't seen, I very much encourage anyone to go see this
mm-hmm.
because it's another conversation starter, thought-provoking piece about the reality of what's going on in
right.
our community. And then we're the last speaker is going to be Lance Williams, Dr. Lance Williams from
uh-huh.
Center for Inner City
yes.
Studies.
Yes.
This is a blockbuster lineup.
Right.
People who not a leader discussion, but people who don't just talk the talk. They walk
they
the
walk.
Walk
the walk. Right.
They are
That's
involved
right.
actively
right.
in our community, and they take away your excuses. Because when you hear a little bit about all of their personal stories,
right. That's right.
they take away your excuse because they put
right.
themselves on the front line.
That's right.
All of us have a part to play, and that's what this is really about.
Man, that's beautiful.
So we're really proud of that. That show, Tangled, is running
mm-hmm.
Thursday through Saturday,
mm-hmm.
8 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
and Sunday, 3 at 7.
Okay.
And this runs through May the 19th.
May the 19th.
So there's
how
time.
How can people get tickets?
Call ETA
mm-hmm.
At 773-752-3955, 773-752-3955, or check out our website, etacreativearts.org,
mm-hmm.
or even our Facebook. So there's many ways to get us.
Right, right.
We like to say all roads lead through ETA one way or another. So.
That's right, man. And I love it. I love the institution and was happy when I heard that you came over there to
yes.
to take it into a next phase of growth. I know there's a lot happening And there's some growth and stuff happening at ETA. Talk to us about that as well.
Oh, there's a lot going on. And just even in terms of the programming, you know, we had been focused on expansion, I think, in terms of the physical stuff. But we're doing expansion in terms of partnerships and our programming and pushing it out through partners. Uh-huh. So we have this wonderful partnership with the Urban Health Initiative at the University of Chicago develop a play called It Should Have Been Me, which was written by Dorianne Miller from the center, who wrote this play as a therapeutic intervention to kids who witnessed violence, because she was noticing in her clinical practice that kids exhibit symptoms that look like post-traumatic stress disorder for war veterans.
Right.
Because they're seeing all this stuff. So she wrote this play, brought it to ETA, and it was developed through our dramaturgical services into a full-length play that we do for schools. Mm-hmm. And so we're bringing in school groups from all over the city to see this play, and then there are post-show conversations after that. Mm-hmm. Similarly, and I don't think adults out there really understand the impact of all this violence on our kids. Mm-hmm. When we do these post-show conversations with the children and ask the kids, how many of you know somebody who has been killed, one of your friends or peers, invariably at least 3/4 of the hands go up.
Wow. Out of a group of how much?
And it's a 200-seat theater.
200, wow.
So
I mean, that's a lot.
That's a lot. What I'm saying is that the kids are experiencing this every day. Now, how do you expect them to go, concentrate on school, excel, when they're worried about their personal safety?
Right.
And, you know, I grew up in Englewood. A lot of us grew up in Englewood or tough communities, what we thought was tough in the 60s, 70s, and even 80s.
Right.
What kids are experiencing now is magnitudes beyond that.
Yes.
In terms of the level and the casualness and the commonplace nature of violence and serious violence with weapons. You know, people are not, they're not duking it out. You know, you're not having these fist fights.
Right.
You're having people reaching for guns.
Right.
And now that, you know, drug market has kind of dried up to a significant extent, there's a lot of tension. There's not a lot of, you know, economic activity in terms of employment is down. Mm-hmm. So I think this is adding to this increased tension in our neighborhoods. I know everybody feels it. It's palpable. You can feel it. That's where we have to come in. We have to step in and take control of our community. Right. So this It Should Have Been Me is a wonderful show. And between It Should Have Been Me and Tangled, ETA is trying through its art to address the problem. Not just acknowledge that it's there in a broad way, but create conversations about it, because you can't attack something until we talk about it. We're a community, we're a family, and we've got to deal with this.
That's right, and face it head on. Now, talk a little bit about the directors and the playwrights, because I've heard some great stories about how you all help develop new talent and people who have, you know, some skills in the area but really need to find a platform and a venue.
Yeah, absolutely.
So talk about development and what you all do for young people that are trying to express themselves.
So we have classes in dance, music, and drama for youth and adults. Our Saturday classes are for kids 6 to 12. Mm-hmm. And then those kids perform a Saturday matinee every Saturday, 2 o'clock. Mm-hmm. The children perform a show called Kasimu and the Coconut Palm. It's on Saturdays. It's a great show, $5 ticket. It's another way to come and support, but you get to watch all the incredible talent these young people have.
Wow, that's beautiful.
And then we have adult classes for folks in playwriting and drama for adults. And even if you don't think you're going to do this professionally, it's a wonderful way to learn how to express yourself, kind of get these ideas, and people do go on. We've had people, plays that we've actually taken on that have come through that process. 90% of the plays that we do at ETA are either first-time produced or seldom produced in Chicago. So we're very proud of the fact that we're bringing new plays to the stage. The play that we have, Tangled, this is the first time it's been professionally produced in a theater. So we're proud of being able to add to what's called the canon of black plays from stuff, really contemporary writers who are dealing with the issues that people can relate to right now. That's a big part of our mission. But we also do training in the areas of theater and arts that's behind the scenes. Everybody sees the stuff in behind, but you don't see the folks who put the lighting together, do the sound design, and do the costuming and the set, stage, and building the sets, designing the sets.
Right.
There's all kinds of work that we have trained people for who have gone on and now work in the major theaters around the city and other parts of the country.
Mm-hmm.
So that has been an important part of our mission, is to train and develop talent and give them opportunities to work in a professional setting. And this is real money, real work, real careers.
Mm-hmm. Man, that's beautiful. I know, you know, at one point I have a love of history.
Yes.
And at one point, talking to a friend of mine, I was thinking about going into stage, developing stages and movie sets, because there's so much history that you have to know with certain movies and things that you're doing. So there's such a wonderful cross section. Sometimes people may have one interest that they think is totally opposite of another one.
Yes.
And in the theater and in entertainment, there's a great way to blend them. And I love also what you said about, I think it's so important for us. I've gone up north with, there are a lot of different theater groups, and whether it's comedy or stage, and you have a lot of people who are not trying to be the next, you know, Jim Carrey or Steve Harvey, but they are just using that as a way to express themselves.
Absolutely.
They're becoming better business people because they're learning how to communicate.
That's exactly right.
So there are all kind of skills that you all are helping people to have, whether or not they want to be a great entertainer or a better business person, get their career on a different track. So, man, I love what
there is no doubt about that, and for our kids especially. When they do the acting and drama and dance, it develops poise, it develops discipline.
Right.
Stuff they're going to use in any walk of life, regardless of whether or not they want to be in the arts.
Right.
These are essential life skills that they learn. Learning how to work with other people. Mm. Theater is a collaborative exercise. You know, it's our trick is the art and the science of theater is to make it look easy, to make it look natural, so
right.
that you forget everything that's happening.
Right.
But everything has to be very well coordinated, and you have to be able to learn to work and collaborate with people that are doing completely different disciplines, but we come together to make a moment. And then you have to be in that moment. And I know you know that being able to be in the moment can separate an average person from a person that excels.
Yes.
If you know how to be in that moment. And that's basically what kids and adults get out of our training classes fundamentally.
Mm-hmm. Man, that's beautiful. Yes, and you see it. You see it from business. You see it in entertainment. You see it in sports. You know, the great ones are there in the moment and focused. No matter what else is happening around them, they're focused on the goal and the task.
That's right. And what I really want people to understand is these institutions, ETA is 41 years old, they need support. They need your support, and no amount of support is too small. You know, you could send $10, $5. Is 41 years old, you could send a dollar for each year that ETA has been. That money is so important. It helps keep the lights on. It helps pay the staff, pay these actors. We pay all of the actors, all of this stuff that's going on.
Mm-hmm.
These are professional gigs for folks. And it's important because they will go away around the country in this economy.
Right.
The foundation money is down. The money that comes from businesses, you know, corporations to support this kind of stuff, all of the sources of revenue are down.
Mm-hmm.
And they will go away.
Mm-hmm.
But they're important. It's important that we have things in our community that are about us. You know when they're not there.
Right.
So
that's
while
right.
we have a chance to nurture them, you know,
one
of our founders, Okoro Harold Johnson, who passed away, we had his memorial last week. And he's been incredibly influential and trained many artists and actors in Chicago. There was something that was said by one of the people at his memorial that just has stuck with me since, and that, you know, 50 years ago, when they were coming up and thinking about starting institutions, the theater, black theater scene in Chicago had much more theater going on independently than it does now.
Right. Right.
And I hear that from various business people in various kind of walks of life and sectors, that actually in a way we're not doing as much as we used to do.
Right, right.
That we've, you know, in a way segregation made us dig deeper and rely on ourselves.
That's
and
right.
once we had the larger market, we kind of forgot about that homegrown stuff. But now we see when we have to employ ourselves, when unemployment is low, we have to turn to each other. We have to turn to our own community, own businesses, and our own wherewithal.
That's right, brother. You're absolutely right. And, man, you just highlighted a couple things that we definitely love to talk about and what we were just talking about earlier. when we support, so you have different ways. You have corporations that can give donations and support. You have ticket sales. You have what else? What are some of the other avenues?
Oh, we have our special events. In fact, we have our special event coming up, our Springboard Benefit, which is May the 20th at ETA. $55 is the cheapest ticket for one of these in town. We try to keep things affordable for our community. In the fall, we have our big gala, our annual gala. So that's a way. You know, individual giving, just the annual gifts people send to us.
Right.
In philanthropy, in charitable giving, in nonprofit world,
right.
Although you have foundations and corporations and big businesses giving, cumulatively, proportionally, percentage wise, the biggest number comes from individuals. Wow. Individual giving is at least 70% of all charitable giving across the board. Whether or not we're talking about a university, particularly churches. Think about it. It's individuals and not giving in large amounts all the time.
That's right.
So little dollars add up to big dollars.
That's right.
And that's
right.
What we have to think about. That we do, there's no such thing as little dollars when we're talking about getting in the habit of supporting our own.
Beautiful. And so, when brothers and sisters, we're definitely going to encourage you to support ETA, go to the events, go to the plays, send in some contributions. And what's the website?
It is www.etacreativearts.org.
Go there, make a contribution, and then you have your support behind an institution that when job opportunities come up, when you have your daughter who is 3 years old now, when she's 12 and she wants to learn stage play, she wants to learn directing, she wants to learn different things, that's a place where she can go.
Absolutely.
And it may be a place where she can learn and get a job and be able to express herself.
We've had kids going to Disney, get Disney contracts, do all kinds of things out of ETA. It's amazing.
And brother, I know you're in a wonderful place because I can't tell you that there's not talent in Chicago because see it all the time.
All the time. And I'm looking at talent right here, and I just have to say really quickly, man, I have always admired what you do.
Yes, sir.
From the being, you know, I've known you many times and your many hats that you wear, and I see what you do in the community. It's an amazing, and you're just the kind of brother we need more of, and appreciate you, brother.
Man, well, I appreciate you, brother, and our paths have crossed, of course, from Morehouse and in your hats as well. So, and you've always been there with clear advice and guidance and instruction on the different hats when you were, you know, helping to give money to community organizations.
Right.
Through another business, another company you were working with, foundation, and man, we just love everything that you've been doing. And man, I'm so glad to see. This is the first time I've seen you since.
Since I left the Chicago
first
Community
conversation,
Trust.
First good conversation we had.
We see each other at these other events that we support.
That's right. Well, man, always. Okay, the mice tell me don't hit the table anymore. I have a habit of hitting the table. He's gonna get tired of telling me after a while. We may have to put us a granite. I'm gonna have to spring for a granite table, a marble table or something.
There you go.
But brothers and sisters, it is almost at the end of the show. We are so happy and pleased for all who have been tuning in to the Being Soup Radio Show. I've been your host for this hour, Tori Muhammad, and we'll be your host next week. And brother Phillip, I just want to say, anytime you want to come on and talk about what ETA is doing, you're more than welcome. And also, whatever I can do, I want to pledge to be a part of helping, contributing in-kind contributions to promoting the gala and helping to make sure that as many people in my network that I can touch would know about it.
Man, that's beautiful, and we appreciate that. And likewise, man, I love what you're doing with this vehicle, getting vital information to the community. Man.
Yes, sir. That's
absolutely.
What's up. That's what it's about.
Yes, yes, yes.
So we're going to close out this show, brothers and sisters. Thank you again for listening to the Bean Soup Radio Show. And as I always say, as long as I have a bowl of bean soup, you've got half. Peace.
Engaging talk radio starts now. This is GlobalNewsForum.com, Chicago.